We're continuing our tour of the sensory systems today with the olfactory and gustatory systems. That is your smell and your taste systems. And we're going to hit on some familiar themes as we talk about these two predominantly chemical sensory systems. My name is Virginia Spielmann. I'm the Executive Director at STAR Institute for Sensory Processing Disorder in Greenwood Village, Colorado. So let's talk about the gustatory and olfactory systems. As I said, they are really chemically based systems. They utilize chemoreceptors to take in information about smell and taste. And so it sounds simple and straightforward, but of course, as we've talked all the way through this series, they are very emotionally laden sensory systems, and they're also sensory systems whose first job is to keep us safe, to keep us away from danger, to keep us alive. When we are in utero, our gustatory and olfactory systems are already somewhat working. We are familiar with the taste and smell of our mothers, and specifically our mother's breast milk, really from the first days of life outside the womb. And what that does is that helps with the attachment and bonding process. So you can see these are emotional systems in their function, as well as, of course, remembering that when sometimes a really powerful smell can take us straight back to a very emotional memory. We can be back there right away, can't we, when a smell can take us on that journey. And it's interesting that the neural wiring for smell actually bypasses the thalamus, unlike a lot of our other sensory systems, and has a more direct route to the cortical areas. And they think that that might explain how there's this powerful function of smell to take us back to these memories. And so we know that these systems are somewhat affective, somewhat emotional, and have hugely important functions in attachment and bonding. So in the infant, at bonding to mum and smelling mum and being able to be familiar with the taste of mum even. There's also some research that says it helps us in how we choose our partner, how we choose our mate, smell specifically. And so very interesting to think about how the evolutionary purpose of these sensory systems, how important they are. And again, you know, what we've done in our culture nowadays is to think of them somewhat simplistically. You know, smell and taste are to do with food, perhaps to do with having a good palate. But they serve all these purposes. So attachment, emotion, that ability to have a really strong memory. And then, as I said, keeping us alive. If we smell something dangerous, our alarm bells go off internally right away. And also taste will control what we eat. We will spit something out if it tastes bad. It's very hard to inhibit that response. So if we taste something that might be poisonous, it might have gone bad, it might give us food poisoning, that the brain says, nope, deadly, and we spit it out. Now think about that, because you can have the best intention in the world to eat healthy food, and go on a diet perhaps, or, you know, eat whole foods, and your brain is fully invested in this, your wallet is fully invested in this, and you will still eat the Cheetos if the Cheetos are put in front of you. And so our brain in controlling what we eat is less powerful, our upstairs brain, than our lower brain and our taste buds that say, no, danger, get it out. What does this all mean? Well, let's think about it. The power of taste and being repulsed by taste to make us spit out our food is really strong. And so what if we are over responsive to taste? What if we have disordered processing of taste? And we're gonna look like perhaps picky eaters. We might look like, you know, we've got really bad table manners. We might be difficult at mealtimes, and we might therefore develop some problem feeding habits, some disordered feeding, maladaptive feeding patterns. And you know, so sensory processing in this arena of olfaction and gustatory senses can impact participation in activities of daily living like feeding. And then you also have big responses perhaps, and I know I'm talking just about over-responsivity here, but big responses perhaps to smells might make a child have a big body response that looks like poor manners, looks like being rude. They can't speak to this teacher because of the perfume she wears. They can't go to grandpa's house because of the smell of, you know, maybe grandpa likes dried fish. You know, these different things. So over-responsivity to smell and taste can disrupt activities of daily living, can disrupt attachment potentially, and might make a brain and body think that everything's unsafe when actually it isn't. There's also going to be discrimination challenges if we're under-responsive, or if we're just not really able to figure out what things mean from those sensory systems, that are probably going to impact those same domains. Feeding, neuroception, determining if something's really threatening or if it's actually fine, attachment and bonding and relationships. Okay, what we're going to talk about next time is the visual system. I look forward to seeing you then as we continue this tour.